innovative spirit of an entrepreneur are the hallmarks of his personality. Like Ehsaas-e Gujral, we will have a session where Mr. Rohit Bansal, one of us living in our sector, whom you heard 2 years back on the future of jobs and education in India, will conduct the proceedings where Mr. Sanjeev Bikhchandani will share his experiences, his knowledge, and his expertise with all of us. I will not go into the list of awards which he has won or which have been conferred on him, but one award comes outstanding. Outlook magazine has rated him one of the best 50 CEOs of this country. It's our privilege to have him amongst us this evening, and I'm sure you will enjoy and benefit from his experiences. Now I request the president of the club, Mr. Anand Shukla, to welcome them and escort them to their respective chairs on the stage. I hand over the proceedings of this evening to Rohit Bansal, who will conduct them. Thank you.
Good evening. One of the things that Bagla Saab did not mention, and I think is very important in this context, with your permission, that Sanjeev is a member of this club. I think that's the most important part of this evening, that we have here in our midst a corporate member, and not only him, but some of his top management uses the club, and they seem to enjoy the experience a lot. So thank you very much for bringing this on.
In fact, there are several people whom I know in this room, and I think this is a very fine institution. I use the club often. I think it's a great neighborhood, and one of my, original thing was that one day I will live here, okay? But my wife and my mother said, we want to live in South Delhi. And so I want to live here, I still do, but other people decided otherwise, yeah. But I have many friends here. I think, Deepak Bagla and I were in school and college together. Mr. Rajiv Ratan Shah is a very old and senior, mentor from the government, who actually had a huge role in helping the Indian IT industry. I think we have many people I know, Mr. Goyal, Indrajit Sayal, Mr. Anand Shukla, all friends. Thank you.
Great. So Sanjeev, I think without much ado, I think the ball has been set rolling with the characteristic aplomb by Bagla Saab. I thought we will do this in a fireside format where I'll try and preempt some of the questions that might be in people's minds, but with an audience as eclectic and scholarly as this, some people who have actually run this country, others who are, so active in the corporate sector now, it would be foolhardy on my part to assume that I even know 5% of the questions that might come. But I was just wondering if you could tell us in an anecdotal way, what was the gap between you graduating from St. Stephen's College and Naukri.com coming up? Did it happen like within a few days, a few weeks, a few months?
No, looking back in hindsight, I think everybody, to succeed goes through a longish period of struggle, and so did I. Where you're discovering, stumbling along, making mistakes, getting up, finding yourself, and figuring out what to do. So I finished from college in Delhi University, St. Stephen's, in 1984. I worked for 3 years in advertising in Lintas, where I had the privilege of working with Mr. Rajiv Ratan Shah. We were doing a campaign for the government of India to promote Indian exports to the US. And he was working on the government side, and we were working together. Of course, I was a trainee, and he was very, very senior. So, you know, my boss, my boss's boss, I would be there in meeting, but keep quiet mostly, right? I did that for 3 years, and then I went to IIM Ahmedabad, and then I worked in consumer marketing for 2 years in a company that is now called GlaxoSmithKline, then was called HMM after various mergers and acquisitions, now called GlaxoSmithKline. I was in marketing, handling the brand Horlicks, working on the brand Horlicks. I did that for 2 years, and then I quit in 1990 and became an entrepreneur. And essentially, I drifted for 7 years. Right?
7 years after 1990, so we are in 1997. From 1984.
So I did 100 small things, and without seeming to go anywhere. And we launched Naukri in 1997, as Mr. Bagla pointed out. And that was at that time one more small idea, right? Because at that time there were only 14,000 internet accounts in the country. So I thought that 50 छोटी चीजें की हैं, तो 51 वाली भी हो जाए, देखते क्या होता है. And this happened to be right place, right time. Worked hard, worked smart, got lucky. The internet took off. It was the right time, just at the ground floor. I was on the ground floor, and it just took off, and we had tailwind. And we bootstrapped Naukri for 3 years, somehow surviving. I wasn't able to take a salary, but we managed to survive. And then in the year 2000, we managed to get what then was a large sum of money, but now is a small sum of money, given the kind of funds startups raise these days. We raised about 7 crores from ICICI Venture. We got lucky because we raised this money just 2 weeks before the meltdown. So we didn't have time to spend the money foolishly, which we would have certainly done if we had more time, right? We just put the money in fixed deposit in the bank. We tore up the business plan we had presented to ICICI, saying this is not going to do this. And we began to grow the company the hard way. We didn't spend much on advertising. We moved the office out of my house, and we moved it to Noida. We took a small office on rent in the back lanes of Noida, Sector 5, with open drains between rubber and chemical factories, paying 12 rupees a square foot rent. We hired salespeople, we built new products, technology, servers, and we grew the company small. 2 years we made losses, and then we became profitable. And since then we've been.
And when did you go public? 2006.
2006.
So nearly 22 years since you passed?
22 years. 20 years since I finished college, we went public.
Wow. So I just thought we should mention this for the simple reason, Sanjeev, that here it's an audience which has extremely senior people, and as most of them have children, grandchildren, and friends who are doing young startups. So a journey of even 22 weeks or 22 months appears very long, and people think that why isn't success happening to me and my child or my grandson or whatever. So here is a man who's sitting with us, 2 billion market cap of Naukri.com, and Bagla Saab, Zomato and his other investments are independent. So Zomato itself is valued at 2 billion, where Naukri.com or InfoEdge has a stake. So with that type of success today, it's very easy to think that the success would have come sooner than 22 years. But to my mind, it's an important number to carry when we carry the rest of the evening with us. Do you think that with 14,000 internet accounts and today 500 million plus, and the government wants us to believe that there'll be even more as things go, my own company is helping in mobile internet in a significant way. What is the common thread from your success story, and what can be the relevant thing for an audience today? So that we know that what is really common in these 22 years and what can be left behind, because there's no point in talking of power shortage or of bandwidth shortage, because there is a lot of ubiquity of the internet today. So what is common that has held ground today as well?
So I think a few things haven't changed. I think the importance of customer focus, right? The importance of innovation, the importance of being first mover and a pioneer, I think these remain the same. And when there's abundance of capital, should there be abundance of capital, very often companies that raise too much money too easily tend to spend it suboptimally. Because what's not scarce, you do not value. And if you don't...
Give me an example, because you mentor a lot of startups. You are in Thai, the Indus Entrepreneurs. You have a mentoring role in the Ashoka University setup, which a lot of kids these days prefer over the undergrad college you and I happen to go. So what is really the common thread?
So look, one common thread is what I believe is that successful businesses are built on deep customer insights. Deep customer insights about what? About an unsolved problem. So if you solve an unsolved problem for a customer, you have a very high chance of succeeding. If you solve a problem, then the customer will come to you.
What problem? Give me an example. Okay.
So we invest in many startups. We have invested 22 startups. We have invested 1,400 crores across 12 startups over the last 10 years. You know, in Zomato, in Policy Bazaar, and several others. Now, one of the most important questions I ask an entrepreneur when I meet him, where did you get this idea from? Ye idea kahan se aaya? The guy tells me, you know, this is happening in the US, so I thought it'll work in India. I mean, maybe it'll work in India, but that's the wrong answer for me. Now, one example I'll give you, Zomato. So Zomato used to be called Foodie Bay. I used to use the site, I liked it. And then one day we thought, why not talk to them for investment, right? So I found out who founded it, Deepinder Goyal. I traced him on the net. I sent him an email cold. I did not know him. And I said, I'd like to talk to you. We invest in startups. If you're looking to raise money, please call. This is my number. He called me within 2 days. And we met. And the first question I asked him was, you know, Deepinder, you're doing a great job, but where did you get the idea from?
So I'll just interject. How many of us know about Zomato? Okay. Sanjeev, so you've gone well. So he's got 1,400 crore invested in 22 startups, and I think the iconic investment that Sanjeev has made is in Zomato, though he may say that 21 others are just as good and ready to go. So he's talking about Deepinder Goyal of Zomato. I thought I'll just get a sense of if people
knew. So Deepinder Goyal graduated from IIT Delhi in 2005. I met him for the first time in 2010, so he was about 28 years old. And he was doing this startup, which just listed restaurants, and doing 1 lakh a month of revenue, right? And somehow, you know, somehow surviving, right? But getting traffic, right? And I asked him, "Ye idea kahan se aaya? Where did you get the idea from?" And he told me a very simple story. He says, "I was after IIT Delhi. I got a job at Bain Consulting. Bain Consulting had an office in Gurgaon. Maybe 50, 60 people working there, mostly male, mostly single, mostly young. Very many from out of Delhi, so mummy wouldn't give them lunch to take to office, right? There was a cafeteria in the office, but it would not serve food. You could order in and eat it there, right? And to help all the employees, the admin team had put together a file folder in the cafeteria of menus of various restaurants where they could decide, you know, what they wanted to eat, look at the menu, and order in. And Deepinder said, "Yaar, line lag jati thi ek baje." You know, only one file. And you couldn't take it to your desk. It's a shared resource, all of that. So you had to see it there only. So it says one Saturday I came in and I scanned these menus and I put them on the office intranet on my personal page. He says within 2 days, the IT infrastructure guy came to me in office and said, "Yaar, what have you done? Why is all the office traffic going to your page?" Right? And so the penny dropped. The prospective customer, the public was telling me, there is value in aggregating menu cards. And he says, so I went to my CEO of India office and I said, I want to do a personal project on weekends, and he gave him permission. And he went to 800 restaurants on weekends and just picked up menu cards. And he scanned them and put them up on the net, and traffic began to come on its own, one of them being me. So I think the customer gives you a signal. So if you follow customer signals, so, you know, don't produce an idea out of a hat, often in the US. Observe customers. If you observe customers and you launch something which you know the customer likes, but the customer has told you, or he's told you in some signal without explicitly telling you, right, you have a much higher chance of success. So don't start a business without a customer signal, right? And the second thing I tell young people is that, look, the customer's money, see, all headlines about investor monies. So, you know, so-and-so raised so much money, so-and-so raised so much money, so-and-so raised so much money. There is no headline about customer money. भाई इसने इतना पैसा रेस किया लेकिन सेल कितनी हो रही है, प्रॉफिट कितना हो रहा है, प्रॉफिट हो रहा नहीं हो रहा, देयर इज नो टॉक अबाउट दैट, राइट? एंड आई ऑलवेज टेल देम दैट द कस्टमर्स मनी इज बेटर देन द इन्वेस्टर्स मनी एंड मोर इंपॉर्टेंट. द कस्टमर्स मनी इज बेटर देन द इन्वेस्टर्स मनी एंड इट इज मोर इंपॉर्टेंट देन द इन्वेस्टर्स मनी. द रीजन बींग, अगर आपके पास कस्टमर का पैसा आ रहा है और रिपीटेडली आ रहा है एंड इट्स कमिंग एट अ प्राइस दैट इज हायर देन योर कॉस्ट, देन यू हैव अ वायबल बिजनेस. एंड इफ यू गेट कस्टमर मनी, द इन्वेस्टर्स मनी विल फॉलो बिकॉज इन्वेस्टर्स लव टू इन्वेस्ट बिहाइंड बिजनेस एंड अगेन कस्टमर मनी. बट इफ यू गेट द इन्वेस्टर्स मनी, इट डज नॉट मीन द कस्टमर्स मनी विल फॉलो बिकॉज गेटिंग द इन्वेस्टर्स मनी इज मेकिंग अबाउट मेकिंग अ स्लिक पावर पॉइंट प्रेजेंटेशन टू 26-year-old MBAs across the table and persuading two people. But the customer in the market is unforgiving. He will not give you his money because he's impressed by a PowerPoint. He will give you money because he finds value in what you're selling. So I say focus on the customer, and that has not changed. But as long as there's a flood of liquidity, it's the easier option is to raise investor money.
Right.
But not the smarter option.
Right. So I think those who might be here thinking that if they listen to Sanjeev, he might even invest in their startups can be suitably disappointed. But on a lighter note, you mentioned somewhere that what you tell young people. Are you saying that those who are not young are incapable of being entrepreneurs?
No, I would not say that. But I'll tell you one thing. You see, there are various kinds of companies and businesses. Now, if you want to raise venture capital money, right? Then you are fundamentally committing yourself to, you'll build a large company and you'll grow very fast, right? Because venture capital funds invest on that premise that I will get 10x return in 5 years, 7 years, right? Otherwise, I will not invest. Okay, now, the truth also is that, therefore, you have to provide them an exit. Exit means IPO, or it means a sale of your company to somebody else, right? Now, the honest answer is that usually to build a large company from startup to scale and exit is a 12-15-year time horizon in India. It's not a 5-6-year time horizon. Now, 15 साल में ना एक कंपनी बनाने में आदमी का तेल निकल जाता है. It is hard, right? So you want to actually, when you invest, you say, okay, you know, this guy is 28 years old today. What will he be like 15 years from now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now? You're taking those kind of bets, you know, and that's not easy, and you're often wrong. You know, will he be good with people 5 years from now? Can he run a 5,000 person team, 1,000 person team? Those are soft factors that are hard to assess, you know, unless a person has a track record and experience. So the ideal age, according to me, is somebody who can have a 15-year time horizon in front, but has sufficient thing at the back that he's demonstrated some of this, right? But in life, you know, when you go out in the market, there are no ideals. You know, you could have a great guy running a great business, but, you know, he's 45 or 50, right? At 70, you will ask, what's the succession plan? What's the second line like? Maybe at 50 or even you'll ask it. Because you're investing for 10 or 15 years. Otherwise, you can't get an exit. Now, on the other hand, if you want to be an entrepreneur, say, listen, I don't want to raise venture capital money. I've got some money of my own, or I know what I'm going to sell will work, and I'll get customer money. I'm okay without external funding of the venture capital type, right? By all means, do it at any age. But venture capital comes with strings attached.
So we've talked a bit about Naukri at the outset, and we've talked a little bit about Zomato and the backstory of you and Dipinder Goyal. Tell us the backstory of one or two of your other startups. Wo idea kahan se aaya, kaise koi, jaise in the case of Zomato, I didn't know this all these years that you had called up Dipinder, which is quite you actually. The other way is that Naukri, I heard that you have spoken about it in some interviews, that it was about checking out Business India and people are sitting in the office and looking at the back pages of Business India first, which, as you might remember, some of you had job listings. So he thought, why don't we bring job listings on the internet? Tell us about, say, 99 Acres or Jeevan Sathi.
So look, 99 Acres, one of our directors, independent directors, you know, he lives in the US, and his you know, family, his in-laws, owned a property in Old Delhi, right, which he tried very hard to sell. And he discovered the real estate market was really opaque, right? And it's impossible to get the right price. And even if you get a price, you don't know the right price. Are you getting cheated? You know, what's going on? There's no benchmarking. There's no reputation analysis of, you know, of brokers. And he came to us and said, you know, this market, I think, is ripe for internet simply because there is so much opacity, right? We started from there, that insight, from one of our director's personal experiences, right? Jeevan Sathi wasn't so much built on a customer insight, I think, which is why we continue to struggle. You know, we are number three. So it's not that we got everything right.
But what about Policy Bazaar?
Policy Bazaar was a, you know.
You guys have heard of Policy Bazaar? Yeah. Okay, fine.
So Yashish Dahiya, the founder, you know, both my co-promoter Hitesh Oberoi and I, you know, knew him from before. We met him, and he said, I want to do this company which compares insurance policies. And I said to him, yeah, but, you know, will it work? He said, I guarantee you it'll work. I said, how? He said, look, I guarantee you that you are paying 50 to 60% more for your car insurance than the lowest quote. And I said, okay. So he said, tell me your car model, year, number of kilometers, self-driven or driver, and I'll give you quotes from different insurance companies, and you then show me what you're paying. And sure enough, I was this. He produced a bunch of quotes, which are live, real time. I was, you know, the lowest quote was, you know, 40% lower than what I was paying. And he said the insight is that, look, people just buy car insurance when they buy the car because the dealer tells them that this is the insurance, right? And you renew with the same person because he sent you a reminder, and you know, it's a no-brain decision. But if you go shopping and you compare, you will find that you are paying too high a price in 90% of the cases. And when I saw that, I said, you know, this will work. You know, if Indians believe they're paying too much for something, they will always find a lower price, right? So we backed them, right? So it's not based on that experience, that insight. So wherever we have been first mover, wherever we have been innovator, wherever we have solved an unsolved problem, we have found that success comes to us much easy. Wherever we have been follower, number three, number four to enter, you know, or not based on a customer insight, not solving an unsolved problem, we have struggled.
So I think it's a good time to open this up so that we get some pushback. People who think that what Sanjeev has said is no longer relevant, for example, taking 22 years to do an IPO, to be a food aggregator, to be number one or nowhere. I think in the company where I work, we were 14, and then we came where we are. So there are changes that are happening, a whole speed, exponential speed at which the internet economy offers us alternatives. No better than Sanjeev to answer. So would some show of hands come up so that we bunch two, three questions, and then Sanjeev can go ahead? The lady, Mr. Shah, anyone at the back? Oh, plenty of. Fine. So we'll take three questions, or four questions in one group, and then take it. Yes, ma'am.
I think people need a mic here. People,
and if you could, for Sanjeev's benefit and mine, identify yourself as well. Thank you.
My name is Anuradha Basu. So my questions are, firstly, why did you quit HMM? And why didn't you just look for another job? So in 1990, that was unusual, I would think, to think about starting your own company. Certainly in the 80s it was, so I'm curious about that. And then the other question is that you said that the customer focus, that's true. I mean, customer pay, that's true, but that's for B2C companies, right? It's difficult to do that if it's a B2B business. And the third question is, you said first mover, That's true, but I don't know. Look at some companies like Facebook, for instance. Sometimes if you're first mover, it's not always the best thing, right? Look at Google. So look at some of the successful companies, and they weren't first mover. They were second mover. So I just wanted your opinion.
Thank you. So this was three questions by one person, but I'll go for three persons. And the answer to your first question should be Bikhchandani. So, Mr. Shah, please. First row.
I have a very short question, and that is that in this business of angel investing and startups, I believe it's quite a risky business, and there are, to every success, there are about, they say there are about five times the failures. What have been your failures?
Limited to this first.
So, since there were three questions there, and therefore I'm getting confused, I'll answer this question first. Then we'll come to that, right? So, our successes, and we really haven't got exits yet, and we don't look for exits because we don't have to give somebody else's money back. We are willing to wait. But our acknowledged successes, acknowledged by the market, are Zomato and Policybazaar, right? We have a bunch of very early companies which have not yet succeeded or failed. It's work in progress. But look, we have, there are some which we have written off or written down. So there was a B2B2C company called Canvera, which was in the business of supporting wedding photographers by supplying them wedding photo albums, that we merged with another company. And there was a company called Maidala, which didn't do that well, which was consumer promotions over mobile. And see, when a company does not do that well, the entrepreneurs are great, right? But there are many reasons why you don't do well. Market circumstances, competition, cost structures, sometimes government regulation. There was a company called 99 Labels we invested in. It was e-commerce. But the regulation came in that, look, you can't get foreign capital. So we said, okay, fine, you know, we won't pursue this further because we don't want to put in that kind of capital ourselves. So there are several failures. There are two home runs, and there are two or three. There's a company called Ustra, which is doing rather well, which men's grooming products, is an online brand. So there are two or three which are moderate successes, and there are two or three failures. But, I would say we have a track record better than many other investors, simply because we've got two unicorns. India mein 16 ya 17 unicorns hain, do humne invest kiye hain, which is a good success rate. So we've been lucky in that sense. We've also been patient because we've stayed for a long time. I mean, we invested in Policybazaar in 2008, and we are still investing. So we are not looking for an exit. I think to succeed, you have to have good spotting, good mentoring, but lots of patience, and then lots of luck. So you work hard and you pray hard. Yeah. Coming to these three questions. So look, it's kind of hard for a second, third, fourth mover to succeed unless they differentiate and disrupt. Right? So in that sense, they become a kind of first mover. Right? So if you look at, if you look at Facebook, what did it do? It gave very intense focus to the Harvard student body first, and then added Stanford. So it became this aspirational thing, and then they slowly opened to other campuses, and then they slowly opened to the public. Okay, and the differentiation was in the feature, the initial differentiation, quality of network, that I'll get to network with Harvard people and Stanford people. So you can succeed, but then you have to differentiate and disrupt. Right? You talked about Jio, right? Number 18, and you're succeeding. You differentiated and you disrupted. You could not go in with the same model and do the same thing. You could have, but by spending maybe 100 times as much money as the competition, which would be completely unviable. But you have disrupted and differentiated. Right? So in that sense, you are still an innovator and still a pioneer. And you're still a first mover in a certain sense. Right? You talked about why did I leave HMM. So look, in my case, it's a long story, but you know, ever since I was, well, no, when I was 10 years old, so how many of us daydream over here? How many daydream?
Nobody.
Oh, just two, three.
Good, thank you. So, you know, everybody daydreams, right? And, you know, and when you're in school, you daydream a little bit more, perhaps, right? So I was, you know, a compulsive daydreamer, right? So when I was 10 years old, I wanted to be Rajesh Khanna. This is 1973. So, okay. Because I'd seen Hathi Mere Saathi. Okay. When I was 11 years old, I wanted to be Sunil Gavaskar because he, you know, 1971 was too young. I was too young to remember that series. But, you know, 1974, I said my Sunil Gavaskar. Right? But somewhere along the way, around 75 or 76, this, you know, I will one day be an entrepreneur. Now, in the mid-70s, unusual for a... My father was in the government, and the doctor in the CGHS. I grew up in government colonies in Delhi. So it was kind of unusual. We were sort of brought up not to be entrepreneurs. We were brought up to study hard, do well in school, get a good college. Like all middle-class Delhi boys and girls, or urban India boys and girls, where parents are in government, I think you're told from day one, you know, listen, there is no family money to inherit. If you don't study, you're toast. Right? So you studied. Right? And, you know, so you did that. Right? But somehow I got this thing in my head. Now, it was a very fuzzy goal, you know, one of those daydreams, you know, Sunil Gavaskar, Rajesh Khanna, entrepreneur. Right? But it kept coming back to me. Right? So by the time I was finishing class 12, I was articulating it as a formal goal in my life that, listen, someday, sometime, I will be an entrepreneur. Right? Now, there are children who will do what their parents did. So, lawyer ke beta lawyer banega, doctor ke beta doctor banega. But then there are kids who say, I'll never do that. So, I was one of the kids who say, I will never do what my father did. I will not be a doctor and I'll not join the government. Right? For whatever reason. Right? And so, then it became private sector. The private sector meant, you know, so my elder brother went to IIT and IIM. So I went to St. Stephen's and IIM, right? And after 5 years of working in the corporate sector, you know, I said, look, this is not the life I want, right? This is not the work I want to do. So I was making a life choice that meko ye nahi karna hai, aur meko kuch aur karna hai. And I will be an entrepreneur, start something, and, you know, and try and figure it out. So that's why I quit. I didn't quit because of a rational reason. I didn't quit because I had a big idea. I didn't quit because I had funding. I was saying, "Mereko ye life nahi chahiye. Main ye life try karta hun." Of course, I was living in my dad's house, okay, and my wife was working in Nestle, you know. So I began to teach at business school. So I had mitigated some risk. I would earn a little income from being visiting faculty at management schools around Delhi. So I was doing all of that, but that's why I did it. For independence, for creativity, for, you know, I didn't have any big ideas. And, you know, truthfully speaking, I didn't want to run a large company. I was very happy running a small company. But things happened and we ended up here. And what are the third question?
And I have heard stories in your interviews. You have mentioned how you were without a salary for a long time and Surbhi Bikhchandani was...
Yeah, we were living off her salary and I was experimenting with my career. You know.
That's
but you know, it takes 2 years. It takes 2 years for a man to get used to living off his wife. after that, you're okay.
Yeah, I'm Dr. Prasad. I'm a neurosurgeon. I thought you disappointed me because you said you need a 20-year start. So I'm not sure if this is the right time to start at 65, but...
No, sir. I said if you want to go public, if you want to raise venture capital.
So I can start but not go public in my lifetime.
10-15 years, sir.
But my quick question is, like you said, like Zomato, that you take a list of restaurants, take their menu, you get started, there's a customer. So yesterday in our group 15A, somebody was looking for a doctor. So if I get a list of all Noida cardiologists, neurosurgeons, blah, blah, is that enough to get that going? How do I rate them? My thing would be I would not recommend somebody on my website unless I have rated them. So what rating agency would I use? How reliable would that be? Is this a good enough idea to get a startup?
So offhand, I cannot pass judgment, but But I would probe in 2-3 areas. First, I would probe is there somebody else doing the same thing or similar things? So competition kya hai and how are they faring? Two is this an unsolved problem? Do your prospective users want this? Is it a problem they're facing? So my limited understanding is that if anybody has lived in a city for a certain length of time, he usually has his networks, right? Second, there's a huge, on medical issues with the doctor, there's this huge trust issue. You will trust a friend's recommendation a lot more than you will trust a third-party website, right? Because the risk you're taking is different. Right? Now, if you go to a restaurant and the food isn't as tasty as the website said, yaar, theek hai, yaar, ek meal kharab ho gayi, agli meal nahi aayenge wahan pe. Right? But you get wrong medical advice, or you get, that's what you worry about. So these are the areas I would probe in, sir. And I would somehow look at the customer first and understand what is it that the customer is having a problem with. Right? Now, on the other hand, I'll tell you, my issue with, if you tell me, I can credibly guarantee you that if you go to this doctor, he will never recommend a procedure because he wants revenue or the hospital wants revenue. Right? He will give you authentic advice, and he's conservative. Therefore, he will not recommend a surgery when there's an alternate method available. And somehow you convince me of that, I'll be your customer for life. That's me. I don't know about others. But I don't know how you're going to lick that problem. It'll mean doctors then endorsing somebody who does this and not endorsing somebody who does not do this. And I have spoken to medical professionals about this idea, but nobody ever was willing to talk and say,
Can I ask? Hi, my name is Ankur. I used to work with Wipro as an account manager until last year when I quit. My heart is kind of racing at the moment to ask the question, however I'll ask. When you started with Naukri, you had an idea, right? And in the market, there were various kind of people who were already publishing jobs. For example, the Business Standard or Business India one that you mentioned, it was in the back cover, right? Likewise, Employment News, Rozgar Samachar, this and that, everything's were there. So that was a channel. You wanted to make it online. So you had a competition, a kind of a threat from these guys. You had a weakness. 14,000 people online, only in India. I mean, today we probably talk of a different thing, but at that point in time, that was a weakness because you were trying to put in a media online, on the internet, and you knew that a relatively very small number of people will come and get to know it, and you'll probably get a very little traffic there. So you had a threat, you had a weakness. I'm coming to that. You had an idea, and you had a gut feel. That's why you had an idea. I mean, that's why you want to pursue it. How did you play your strength against the weaknesses and the threats that already existed at that point in time whenever you started in 97?
So I didn't just have an idea. The idea was based on a deep insight. Sorry. The idea was based on a deep insight. So when I was working in my last job in HMM, and I was in the marketing department, there were 8-10 of us in one open hall, right? In those days, offices are not fancy to steel tables and chairs. So there were no partitions. I could see what people were doing. I could hear what they were saying. I noticed two things. One is when the office copy of Business India would come in, everybody would read it from the back, okay? And they'd start discussing. Yaar, yahan pe ye naukri ja rahi hai, what do you think? Now, these are guys who, this is pre-liberalization. There were just two FMC. So if you wanted FMCG, which is desirable for some people, you wanted an MNC, you wanted Delhi, and you want marketing, not sales. That's head office job, not sales, not field sales job. There were just two companies. There was Nestle and there was HMM. And they would not hire from each other, it seemed. Right? So you were in the best job that you could be in. Yet these guys would look at these jobs and start talking. Right? So insight number one, jobs are a high interest category of information. Right? People will look at jobs. The second thing I noticed was that every week, 2 or 3 different headhunters would call up and try and headhunt one or the other of my colleagues. There were 10, 12 people here, all from the IIMs,
all FMCG, MNC, there's a good talent pool to headhunt from. And they would try and headhunt one or the other of my colleagues. And they would, I could hear the conversation. And these jobs were each time different headhunter, different company, different job, and these jobs are not advertised. So I figured there are a few hundred, maybe a few thousand headhunters, tens of thousands of companies, maybe 1 lakh jobs out there, which are not advertised. So I figured that if you're able to put up jobs in one place, you can get this whole database together of advertised jobs and unadvertised jobs. And the unadvertised jobs were 10, 20 times the advertised jobs because print advertising was expensive. Right? So what you saw in print was the tip of the iceberg. So this is insight number two. Based on this, what did we do? I got 29 newspapers around the country. And we take those jobs, which are advertised there, in our own words, and put them on the net. Now that's the first step. You still have got unadvertised jobs, you only got advertised jobs. But you aggregated them from around the country. You're keeping it there for 30 days. In Delhi, you just get one or two newspapers. The job goes away after one day, and next week you have to find a newspaper, right? So it became the reference point for jobs nationally, around the country, and for 30 days. It's for the archive. Now, when that happened, people began to apply to these jobs. In those days, there was no email, you know? There was no Gmail and Hotmail and Yahoo Mail. So people would send physical copies of CVs, either by fax or by courier, right? And write a covering letter. In the covering letter, they wrote, "I saw your job on Naukri.com." Now the guy had advertised in the paper, not with us. So HR managers began to hear about us. And they began to call up, right? So this is the network is doing the marketing for us now, right? And one day, after 6 months of launch, we got a call from a auto component company in Pune, and I've forgotten the name. And you know, we were in a tiny office in my house, my father's house, and so we had one phone, and you know, landline, there was no mobile phone. You know, and in those days, there was an 8-year waiting list for a landline, right? So it was worth its weight in gold. So it was on, you know, I used to pick up all the phones. And this guy said, "I'm calling from so-and-so place. I've got 6 jobs that I've not advertised in the paper. Can I send them to you?" Or maybe Moose nikal gaya, "Yes, sir, but it'll cost you 350 rupees a job." Okay. I was just thinking on my feet. No reason for 350, just Moose nikal gaya. Right? And that became our price for the next 10 years. Okay, so much more price. But we got that check. 2,100 rupees came. Okay? And we had a revenue model. The moment we did that, and we mailed out to every past advertiser and newspapers because we had the database. And we sent a physical letter saying, "This is internet, this is Naukri, this is the format. You please send us jobs in this format. 350 rupees, single job listing, 6,000 rupees, annual subscription, unlimited jobs for your company through the year." And that 6,000 rupees subscription was a hit. And we got companies to put up all their jobs with us. So suddenly we had aggregated the jobs that had not been advertised. So we had a unique database. And that's how we did it. So we had competition, but we had a strength. We were cheaper. We could give a 6,000 rupee subscription. And we got all the unadvertised jobs. And that got the traffic.
Thank you.
Yes. Yeah.
Hi, good evening. It was really insightful listening to you. I have actually a question. Sorry, my name is Vineet Handa, and I've got 3 sort of decent startups till now.
I got your 3 questions.
I have 3 questions. It's a 1 question, 3
one
parts.
1 question.
3 parts. What do you think about the social startups? Have you invested in any of the social startups?
When you say social, do you mean social networking or social impact?
Not networking, social causes. Okay. And what do you think should be the measure for successful social startup?
Okay, so listen. So, you know, so my daughter, who's now in business school, wants to do impact, you know, startup. You know, my point is simple. If you're in the impact sector, right, and you're not financially sustainable, right, each time you're raising external donations to succeed, you really can't scale because there's a limit to how much capital you can raise. On the other hand, if you are financially sustainable, viable, profitable, you don't have to distribute the profit. You can be a not-for-profit. But if fundamentally the activity you're doing raises its own resources, right, then you can scale a lot and impact many more people. So I would view the social impact startup in the same prism as a what is called, okay? Now, let me ask you a question. So Naukri market cap is 2 billion. You add the investing company, about 3 billion. I don't know how many lakhs of people find jobs through us every year. Are we an impact startup? We are highly profitable. We are listed. We have market cap. Are we an impact startup? Right? We have made impact. We have helped people find jobs. Right? If we had been a not-for-profit, could we have got to the scale? I don't think so. Now, Zomato, it's a for-profit company. It's growing very fast. It's raised a lot of venture capital. It had 5,000 delivery boys in January 2018. It has 85,000 today. It had 5,000 delivery boys in January 2018. It has 85,000 today. It has created 80,000 livelihoods in 12 months. Is it an impact startup? And if it was a not-for-profit, could have done this. So I would ask you to consider these two things. So I'm not a great fan of impact investing unless there's some other compelling reason. And these are people who are not highly, all they can do is ride a motorcycle. They can read a bill. They can collect money. It's not crazy high skill.
So basically, impact as a.
So even for-profit enterprises make impact.
Right.
And for-profit enterprise scale.
Okay.
So impact on scale is very often for-profit. Right. So is Jio an impact company? It is enabling internet in so many people's lives, and it's going to make a profit. It's already making a profit. So it is a for-profit, but it's impact. Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, the actual monthly usage in data has gone up exponentially, and the word is being used so much that we've lost the impact of it in our minds. But it's true that it's in the hands of everybody who is in probably in this profile, and those who work for these people have the use of data, which they had thus far written off. People thought that they are not going to use data, but today everybody does. And even though the calling is free, people use data as a habit, even for calling,
yes,
from their WhatsApps or whatever.
So impact does not necessarily mean not-for-profit.
So Vineet, you have to review the impact part in your mind and make a lot of money for it.
Hi, sir. I completely resonate with your views because I also quit being a Pepsodent brand manager and decided after 5 years that I wanted to start something of my own.
What's your name?
My name is Arpit, and I started something. Again, I didn't have the first mover advantage, but I did have a latent need, which I, presented with a differentiated USP, right? I've just started recently. So
kya karte ho aap?
I have an e-commerce website.
In the area of pets?
Yes, that's right.
Your mother spoke to me.
Okay. I'm grateful to her. I did mention that. So it's again a three-part question, unfortunately, or fortunately for me. First of all, like you said, when you go for funding, of course, I'm bootstrapping at the moment till the point where I can establish the profitability of the business model. But what I'd like to know is that when you approach an investor, how can you cut the strings, minimize the number of strings attached to you, and make sure that they don't expect too much from you while,
You see, it's a pretty much a standard template for most VC investors, okay? And there is a lot of stuff that is not negotiable. They simply will not invest, right? So there'll be a drag-along clause, there'll be a tag-along clause, there will be, time-bound exit, there will be, we can sack the CEO, there will be standard stuff, right? Now, I negotiate. Now, when I raised capital, in April 2000 from ICICI Venture, the truth is, I was a novice, right? I went without a lawyer. I had done one legal course in IIM Ahmedabad, and I thought I could do it, right? When I began to negotiate with the people on the other side, I realized I was out of my depth, but I went and signed anyway, right? Today, of course, I didn't know anybody else who was venture capital. I couldn't talk to anybody because there was not so much VC around that time, right? I think first of all, it's but the thing I had on my side was that there was a boom happening. We were a profitable company. We were a market leader. So we approached four investors. We got three term sheets. Okay, three wanted to invest. We had a crazy hit rate, so we could play one against the other. So the lesson for you is that So again, I tell young people this, young entrepreneurs this, that it's a good idea to raise money when the investor comes to you rather than you going to the investor. Right? You will get your terms of trade, you'll be able to negotiate, develop options. So the fundamental lesson is get your company into a position where you're desirable from the investor's perspective. Which means what? Which means proof of concept, which means unit economics are right, which means brand loyalty, customers, revenue, some margin, maybe break even at a small scale, right? Now, I know in e-commerce it's going to be hard right now to do that. Margins are thin, people expect discounts, there's competition. But maybe we can talk offline on this. Where you're based here?
Yeah,
so,
that's right.
So send me a mail, come over, we'll have a chat.
Sure.
Thanks. This is a longer conversation.
Yes, I'll reserve the remaining questions for then. Okay. Cheers.
Hi, good evening. My name is Shikhar Kapoor. And first of all, I'd like to know, you know, you said you have been bootstrapping a company for 3 long years. All the success stories are always glorified and we have been reading a lot about you. So could you tell us what motivates, you know, the young entrepreneurs to keep running into the company which has been bootstrapped? I know it's not easy. And secondly, what is your take on companies in the likes of Paytm's who do not have any profitability in the long run? Thirdly, I'm also into seed funding and angel investment. So I would like to know what exactly advice would you like to give to a person like me to secure the kind of investment we make? Thank you.
Okay. I'll answer your third question first.
Sure.
Because I remember that better. You know, apart from having asked the right questions and analyzing the company well, which I'm sure you do, right? You should look at one or two things. Invest with a group of angels, not alone. Because many eyes in the company, okay? Invest with smart investors, not just friends of yours because they've got the money. You want to invest with people who are savvy angel investors. Because that's how you learn stuff, that you teach them some stuff, you learn some stuff, right? So join an angel investing group and be active. Third thing I've seen about angel investing, it's good to invest in line of sight. If you're in Delhi, then invest in Delhi. Don't say, hey, there's this 10 other guys investing in Bombay. I don't know the company, but they're okay. You know, the guys are investing, so I'll go along. Not a good idea. Number four, I'd say, you have to, as an angel investor, which is really early stage, very high risk, you got to spread your risk over a large number of companies. So the successful angel investors I have met typically have done more than 100 or 150 investments over a period of 4, 5, 6 years, right? And of course, you've got to ask all the questions I ask, which is idea kahan se aaya, how do you know customer want it, do you have revenue, do you have customers, are people coming back, satisfaction levels kya hai, can I talk to 5 customers, what's the competition, how are you different, koi technology ka moat hai, koi brand ban raha hai, you know, all of that. How does the entrepreneur stay with bootstrapping? Look, I don't know. I'll tell you how I did it. Basically, I didn't have a choice. It's something I wanted to do. We did it. We raised venture capital when we could. उससे पहले हम ढूंढ नहीं रहे थे because available नहीं था. जब available था हमने ले लिया. But we got lucky. So look, what we have not discussed, Rohit, is that role of luck. You know, you may be hardworking, you may be brilliant. You know, I might think I'm a genius, I'm not. Okay, to succeed, you got to be all those things and finally lucky. Okay? God has to be kind. Yeah. And do you have a third question, which perhaps you can move on? Paytm, I would hesitate to say long run they will not be profitable. Their business model is evolving. Nobody's a fool over there. They've got smart investors. They've got a plan. It may take 5 years, it may take 7 years, but I think they have a plan. Now, whether the plan succeeds or not, and to what extent, it remains to be seen. But they have a plan. Indrajit.
I think Sanjeev, today you have created one of the topmost universities of this country, the Ashoka University, which is being talked about all over the world. Why don't you share your experience? How did you start? And what was the motive behind it? And what was the incentive between you guys who invested into it and to launch it as the number one university of India?
Long story. How many of us here studied at Delhi University? Yeah. So did I, right? And I had got into IIT and I got into St. Stephen's and I chose St. Stephen's, right? Now, I think St. Stephen's is a great experience. It's a great college. But when I look back at Delhi University when I was graduating, and I said, this Delhi University could have been a lot better. But not my problem, right? I've got a life to live and career to chase. 20 years after graduating, I met somebody at a conference dinner who had been 1 year junior to me in college. And I asked her, I said, Shalini, kya kar rahe ho? I was meeting her after 20 years, right? And she said, oh, I did MA from D school, and now I'm teaching economics at JMC, or some other college, I think JMC. And I said, really? Kya padha rahe ho? She said, oh, the syllabus has not changed since 1980. This is 2004 or 5. And I said, what? And she gave me a long story as to why syllabus does not change. And I said, so let me get this straight. The Soviet Union has collapsed, has broken up. China has become capitalist. Asian exchange crisis hui thi 6 saal pehle. You can't discuss any of this and ask it in exams? No. It doesn't come in the exams because syllabus is what it is. So I said, okay, something's got to change, but not my problem, right? But finally, it became my problem. When in 2007, St. Stephen's College, where I had studied, and Rohit had studied, announced that we are going to have 50% reservation, which is fine, but the cutoff between the reserved and general will be as high as 35%. Right? So all the alumni, including me, and I suspect you also, Rohit, were anguished at this. He said, look, if 50% of the college is going to be 35% lower in the admission cutoff, then what will happen to the academic quality? And we tried very hard to persuade college management, but they had the views. So that's when I said, okay, it's time to start a new college. Right? So this is one sort of eureka moment. Second was, you see, the company had grown, had gone public. I used to get called to various colleges and universities all over India and overseas sometimes to give talks. And I concluded that Indian institutions have not really evolved since the 70s and 80s. India's students who get into the best colleges are brilliant. But that is more Darwin at work than institutional excellence. So if you take 10 lakh school kids and make them study for 2 years for an entrance exam in quota, right, and then say, I will get admission to top 10,000, you will admit really high quality kids. And if you admit high quality kids, you'll graduate high quality kids. But when I used to compare to institutions I used to visit overseas, I said, we need superior institutional inputs. So the second eureka moment. Third eureka moment was, so my kids are growing up, and my daughter went to DPS Arkepuram in class 11 and 12, as so did my son. And I had come to one more conclusion after seeing all these colleges, is that, look, in India, we have inherited the British system in college, where you pick one subject and study it. In the US, and my daughter was applying to both places, US and UK, you do width for the first 2 years and then you declare your major, right? So you're making a more informed choice about your major. You have the right to switch. You're getting a 360 degree education. So our universities are multidisciplinary, but no student gets a multidisciplinary education because they're studying one subject. So that was eureka moment number four, okay, or three. And finally, I used to go to DPS Arkepuram to talk to the counselor, okay, when my daughter was applying, And there was one counselor, and there were some 500 people applying, so it was like a rugby scrum outside a room. So it would, anybody whose kids went to DPS RKpuram? Yeah, you know what I'm talking about, right? So I used to spend 2 hours in the queue, you know, and I would talk to parents, I'd talk to other kids, and you know, and most of these kids were applying abroad, but they would never be able to go unless they got a scholarship. And most would not get a scholarship. It was frightfully expensive. And I said, why can't we do a high quality college in India at a fraction of the US cost with need blind admissions, which means that those who can't afford it will give scholarships and those who can will pay the full fee. And that's how the idea of Ashoka came about. And it's still work in progress, but I think we've done well so far.
Including being an institution of eminence.
About to be, hopefully. Yes, sir.
Maybe last one or two questions so that we conform to some deadline.
Yes, sir. This may probably be the last question. Sir, my question is that CEOs who are successful, who are also become very popular, tend to be very autocratic also. Now, my simple question is this. How many times, sir, have your employees proved your decision wrong out of 100 decisions? How many times? Second thing, with such employees, do you tolerate them? Do you reward them or do you get rid of them? This is my first question for successful men.
Well, sir, any answer I give you might be biased, but what I like to believe, and I think you can verify this from my colleagues, but to double check, but should you meet any of them, but we must be the most argumentative company in the world, or at least in India. Because one thing we promise any employees who join, that one thing you'll never get sacked for in this company is I disagree with my boss, okay? And we maintain that culture. And it's not that we have a culture strategy, it's just how it's evolved. You know, because when we raised venture capital in the year 2000, we were 9 people or 16 people, right? And now we are 4,000 almost. So when you grew so fast, you took in people laterally. You didn't grow your own timber. Because you could not grow so fast by growing your own timber. You had to get middle managers from outside, senior managers from outside, right? And then you began to grow your own timber. And people brought in their own notions of, you know, what is the right culture, what is the, you know, and from different organizations. So we became a kind of amalgam of various cultures. But one thing was certain, that you could speak your mind. Now, am I autocratic? I like to think not, but who knows? You know, I might well be. But main sochta hu nahi. But shayad main hu. To bhi kisi aur se verify karna padega, sir. So we don't fire. In fact, the board has to. So in the global financial crisis 2008-09, you know, there were 2 quarters when we had minus 25% growth YOY because hiring had been frozen, right? And there was no light at the end of the tunnel. We didn't actually know when this would stop, right? And I just refused to fire. Okay, I was CEO at that time. I'm not a CEO anymore. We just refused to fire. Finally, but the third quarter, the board had to overrule me and give me a diktat that you have to downsize. And I went back and we ideated, and I said, yaar, we can't fire. So we did something called a PIP, a performance improvement plan. We identified 80 people who were not performing well and said, okay, here's how you'll improve performance, and you have 6 months, right? 6 months baad fir growth wapas aa gayi, so.
Well,
we you know, in India, you know, so firing in India scars an organization, sir. And it's, you know, if you actually fire large scale, I think wo family culture, wo malabhi khatam ho jata hai.
But there are interviews on the internet where I've read with amazement how Sanjeev has narrated how many times he had been overruled within his company, and those decisions often proved right. So there are ways in which he has chiseled autocracy into a more inclusive form. Last question,
Sanjeev, how are you mentoring your companies in terms of the new technologies which are coming in, and are providing much newer opportunities, technologies like AI, data analytics, robotics, and so on and so forth. How are you really mentoring your companies towards that?
We have two parts to our operation. One is the businesses we own and run ourselves, which is Naukri, Jeevan Sathi, 99 Acres, Shiksha. These are run by our employees, right? By my colleagues. And then there are companies we've invested in, right? Now, companies we invested in very often in these cutting edge areas may know more than us. So we learn from them. We teach them also, we learn from them. So I think it's about constant meeting, exchange of ideas. But really, new ideas very often come from new people. So if you ask me, do I know AI machine learning? Answer is no. But do we have people in the company, many of whom have joined in the last 5 years, who know it? Answer is yes. So we are alive to the fact that there's new emerging technologies which are going to be useful and which we need to harness and deploy. And then we attract talent who can do it. Okay, and so we've got a team of people who are doing analytics, AI, machine learning, algorithms. Isme 30-40 log hain jo kar rahe hain. And some of them are PhDs from the US, and there's some pretty good people.
So those of you must be wondering what he said in a context that he was CEO, he is no longer CEO. And one of the things intriguing and interesting about InfoEdge, I notice from my perspective, is that he gave the company's running to a very talented compatriot called Hitesh Oberoi. So Hitesh runs Naukri.com and InfoEdge, and Sanjeev's job, as I understand, is take bets. So his job essentially to go outside and grow the whole thing inorganically, but he doesn't run the company. And that's again an offside to the question about autocracy. If he were there, he would have not let go, and Hitesh running it. One more question right at the back, a lady, you raised your hand, madam, if you could just quickly help us with the last query.
So my question is that now today when we see Sanjeev, he has many success stories behind him. But what was the failure which shown you that path?
I wouldn't say failure. I would say struggle, right? So the thing about, the first 10 years before we raised venture capital from 1990 to 2000, I think, I was paranoid about, we never had enough money, right? We were always short of cash. So the key to success was being frugal and keeping your costs low. Because no matter how, because you're in control of your costs, not of your revenue. Right? So no matter how low your revenue may be, as long as costs are lower than that, it's okay. So our primary goal was to survive and not necessarily thrive for the first 10 years. And you could survive by keeping your costs low and by being frugal. Now for the first 10 years, for roughly 6 of those years, I could not take a salary myself, right? I took up second jobs as a journalist, as a writer, as a teacher, as a whatever, just to earn some pocket money, right? So if you keep your costs low, chances are you won't fail. You'll get some revenue, it'll be above your cost. And that's what my philosophy was, and that's what worked. And once we did those 10 years, when we actually raised venture capital, we were so disciplined with money, because we never had money, that we were able to put it to good use.
Mrs. Nath, the point he made also was something offline we were discussing, that for all the big stories we hear of successes, we don't hear 50,000 stories of people who haven't made it. So this is the nature of the beast in the internet and the entrepreneurial ecosystem.
Yeah, so, there's a huge survivorship bias where the survivors are those who've succeeded, right? And those are stories that get told. But for every one film star who makes it, there are 10,000 people who tried and now are waiters in Bombay, and I met some of them.
Mr. Anand Shukla, would you just summarize and make a comment?
I could start with maybe a small question. Now, the question is that you have made it big. You have reached a certain stage in life. Now, do you think the time has come when you forget about the profit and look at what the aggregator business is doing? Maybe let's take Zomato. In fact, the question is borrowed from a very close friend of mine. He said that when you aggregate the business, you drive the competition so much, you take the commission, you don't look at anything other than your pricing and the commission you're getting, and the poor people, they start compromising on the quality, on the quantity of food they are giving for the same amount of money. So is it really good for that vertical of industry, or does this also have a problem in there?
So, main ek cheez bolunga ki markets are competitive and markets are unforgiving. So if somebody is not delivering value for money, he cannot survive in the long run. Right? And therefore, if either Zomato or Swiggy or anybody else is not delivering value to their customers, and their customers are not just... So ultimately, you have to create value for everybody. And I think these are smart people running these companies, and they will figure it out. Now, let me tell you, since you raised the subject of Zomato, so what has happened? So there's a whole industry that's been born purely on food delivery. Okay? So now, if you open the Zomato app, you have the Zomato app on your phone, up 2 baje subah kholiye, right? And see who's delivering food to your neighborhood. 20 or 30 vendors in Aam we never heard of. There are restaurants, there are kitchens, not restaurants, kitchens that open at 10 p.m. and shut at 6 a.m. They're delivering food at 2 a.m., 3 a.m. Now this is creating employment, it's creating revenue, turnover, businesses, right? It's satisfying customers. Okay? This business would not have been possible if these aggregators did not exist. These 80,000 deliverers working with Zomato, 1 lakh working with Swiggy. This is employment, right? They're buying motorcycles. This is creating demand. People are ordering food from these restaurants and these kitchens. There's a whole industry of dark kitchens that's come up where people don't have restaurants. They just have a kitchen and they're just selling on Zomato and Swiggy, right? So this is all economic activity that would not have been possible without this technology platform. So is there competition? Yes. But does it mean people are not making enough money? Maybe you're making a lower margin, but you're selling 5 times the volume and you're making more absolute profit. But look, in the medium term, this will all sort itself out, is my view.
Members of the club, ladies and gentlemen, I have the privilege of proposing a vote of thanks, which I do heartily. And I thank Sanjeev Bikhchandani for giving an excellent talk, and most of all Rohit Bansal for he gave a talk 2 years ago, and today he has been able to draw out the maximum possible. He has picked the brain, let's say, of a giant, and exposed it to us, given a glimpse into the minds of a person who is a successful, very very successful businessman. Apart from that, he has given tech support by which these 4 webcams are transmitting whatever is happening here. To Bombay, from where it's being further transmitted on Facebook, on YouTube, on so many other social media channels. Probably more than 2,000, 3,000 people have watched what we have had the pleasure of watching while sitting here. So I thank you, everyone, and my vote of thanks will not be complete without thanking all of you for giving this, for being a wonderful audience. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.